Andrew, I think what we see with oil traders is they see the geopolitical conflict, but they also see 3 or 4 million barrels a day of excess capacity sitting in the hands of OPEC. And so with that much capacity, 3 or 4% of global supply that will come back to the market over time or could come back in an emergency, the oil markets just aren't that worried if something happens with Iran. So there's this cushion that is keeping the financial traders, I think, pretty sanguine about price. And so it's got some upward bias, but not a dramatic risk premium right now.
Right. And if that's the case, Dan, what would that really mean for the range in which oil prices trade for the foreseeable future? Because there's also all that talk about how Donald Trump is looking at doubling down efforts on pumping out more oil, and drill, baby, drill, of course, being his pet slogan. Mm-hmm. What would that mean for overall oil production coming out of the U.S., thereby putting downward pressure on oil prices, because the U.S. is not going at 13 million barrels per day as of now?
Yeah, I think Trump is absolutely would like more oil production. Let's remember that, you know, the Exxons and the Chevrons, who you just had clips about, they are not ready to step up and spend aggressively, because when they did that during the shale boom, what happened? They overspent, they oversupplied the market, and prices went down dramatically. So regardless of who's president, it's going to be very tough to get the U.S. to add meaningful supply. And so I think that let's take a couple things off the table. Let's take $100 oil off the table because there's excess capacity. But I think let's also take, you know, notably lower prices. Let's take $50 oil off the table as well, because both OPEC are price focused, as well as the big U.S. players. So I think oil's range bound, call it $70 Brent to $90 Brent. And that's a pretty good environment for the oil companies to make money. And it's decent for consumers in terms of gasoline prices and demand.
Another demand story, of course, Dan, being China, as we continue to get day after day more data sort of painting a bit of a softer picture of what's happening over there. How are you looking at that part of the equation?
Yeah, China's been a growth engine for 2 decades, and it's slowing. I think the market knows it's slowing. India is somewhat stepping into that role as a big incremental consumer. If we walk around the world, China's slowing but still growing. India is growing pretty quickly. Europe's mediocre at best, but potentially contracting a bit. And the U.S. is solid at 1 or 2%. You add all that together, demand probably grows 1% this year. It's not a huge number, but I think it's a growing demand number for 2024. And supply's not growing much either. We've got a pretty balanced market. So I think, again, both the supply and the demand side are fairly stable, and we have a hard landing, and markets are a little scary right now, but generally it feels like pretty good balance.